Marietta, Georgia, August 29th, 2004. Two childhood friends, Francis Brom and John Hutcherson, are driving home after a late night of drunken revelry at the bar. Brom, 23 years old, feels ill during the drive and rolls his window down to lean outside the vehicle. As he does so, Hutcherson, 21, unexpectedly swerves while driving the car. Due to the swerve, the vehicle scrapes a telephone pole support wire on the side of the road. The passenger side mirror is torn from the car, and, perhaps unbeknownst to Hutcherson, so is Brom's head. After the accident, Hutcherson continues driving over 10 miles to his parents' home, goes inside, and falls asleep. The next morning, a neighbor, walking by with his baby daughter, discovers the headless corpse in the driveway and calls authorities. Hutcherson was found inside the home asleep, covered in blood, and still visibly drunk. This true and grisly incident is likely the inspiration for one of the more iconic and horrifying scenes in Ari Aster's debut film, today on Debaser, Hereditary.
You gotta kick it off with a killer to grab attention. Then you gotta take it up a notch.
The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us.
Who are you?
I'm Shiva, the god of death.
Cells.
Interlinked.
It's like people only do things because they get paid. And that's just really sad.
You know, we're never going to have a fucking... What was the name of that?
Blackberry.
Blackberry. We're never going to have a Blackberry episode because we fucking recorded it and didn't actually record it.
I didn't hit record at the beginning.
I don't even know that movie. I never.
Oh, it is so
Steven.
Fucking good.
We need to do that episode just to promote that movie.
I know. Give me like another month.
Yeah.
I'll rewatch it.
I saved my notes from it.
Did you? Okay,
yeah,
good.
So I won't have to retype them.
Yeah. Give me another month and... Then we can do
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely. Yeah, because we could just rewatch it and do it again. It's a fun movie.
It's a good movie. And Haley hasn't seen it, so I can watch it with her.
It's a super good movie about the guys who made the BlackBerry phone.
Oh, wait. I did hear about it.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
It's so fucking good.
Okay. Yeah, it's really funny. And
yeah.
Like,
all right.
Yeah. Welcome to Debaser, a film podcast. I'm Jared Rusk, and I'm joined by my co-host, Will. On this show, we explore both new and familiar movies as we attempt to analyze and interpret them, all in an effort to debase the films and ourselves. And we are also joined by a special guest today, Steven.
Hey.
Hi, everyone.
The great Steven. Sorry.
Yeah, it's me. It's me, Steven. Riches to the summoner. Thank you for bringing me on. Appreciate it. I'm really excited about it.
So glad to have you on. Hail Paemon.
Hail Paemon.
That was my second choice, actually. Hail Paemon. Yeah. The click is so iconic, though.
It's so good.
There it is. Thank you.
Yeah. I got you.
Edit out my fuck up.
Get a really clean one for me.
Yeah.
And now throw it away. Okay. It's in the title of the podcast. No more further ado.
Yeah.
We're doing Hereditary.
Hey.
This is maybe the most I've ever prepped for the show.
Yeah, you were watching something when I came in.
I was watching a documentary on the Blu-ray when we walked in.
Literally, it was ending with you-know-who cutting their head off.
Oh, yeah. We're getting into spoilers?
No, not yet, but we'll get there. I think it's been out for a while, so.
Yeah,
I kind of breached containment here.
Yeah, it's fine.
So, this is one of my favorite movies of all time.
Same.
And we're covering it specifically now because it was very recently released in IMAX for a single night only event. Mm-hmm. Will, I'm so sorry. I don't want to rub it in, but you weren't able to make it.
I wasn't able to make it. I was, to brief description, I got hit with the crazy car bill. It got me in my fucking feelings. I didn't want to be stressed out in real life and then going to this IMAX movie and being horrendously stressed out in my relaxed time. So I decided to pass.
You could have had worse car issues, I guess. That's what the movie maybe it out. So it was really awesome that Jared drew my attention to that. It was my first time seeing it. I put it off forever because I was afraid. I like horror movies, but I really just amp myself up and give myself anxiety about things. And I'm so glad I did. I had such a great time.
Yeah, I was going to ask, what's your relationship to horror movies or Ari Aster in general?
Before this, I had seen Midsommar, which, I guess did give me some sense of what I was getting into.
Right, you weren't going in totally blind.
No, and it's like existed long enough that I've, through cultural osmosis, like knew some things, which kind of bums me out. Like I knew the thing about the husband and... My relationship to Ari Aster is I had only seen Midsommar. I really enjoyed it. It has like some pretty intense drama in it. It's very beautiful. That should have maybe jumped into Hereditary earlier, but here we are. But honestly, I'm really happy that I got to see it in IMAX. Like, the sound was crazy. Jared was telling me some comparisons between that experience and his original movie experience. And also, like, the audience was good at our screening.
Well, they were all, like, fans.
They were all sickos, first and foremost. You know what's actually funny? That is the one thing that I'm regretting, because I didn't have a great...
We
both had bad theater experiences when we had first seen the film, and I wanted a redemption to that. So it sounded like there were people who actually wanted to fucking see this movie that were there, which is great.
Well, yeah, and it was a one night only thing. Yeah. And like, if you even knew about it, it's because you're a fan, you know?
So that's my one regret, not going out there. And you know what's funny is Jared was telling me that you'd seen Midsommar before too, and we were talking about, like, that seems to be people's entry into Ari Aster.
I think it's his more popular film.
Yeah, I think it has, like, more comedic elements that, like, might ease people in a bit more.
Yeah.
Sure. I mean, there's maybe, I can only think of, like, a funny thing that happens. Well, I guess depending on your division.
Near the beginning when they're on shrooms and he's like, is that guy walking over here? I can't deal with new people.
There's a bunch of stuff. Just like,
Will Poulter is really funny in that movie.
Yes, he is. Midsommar, I think there's like a lot of kind of funny stuff. And it's like either with like the irony of like what's going on or... but with Midsommar, it's a lot more serious all the way through. Like, I can see it being less accessible to a lot of people.
I think, because on its face, too, I think Hereditary looks like a family melodrama, which it largely is, with a supernatural horror, like, undercurrent that really doesn't raise its head until the last 20 minutes, you know? Spoiler. Don't listen to these if you're going to watch them and don't want to know, so.
Yeah, it's already ruined. Don't even bother watching at this point. I understand, like, I did... hardly any research, but I understand like it was originally written as like a pure family drama, and then the supernatural stuff kind of made its way in. Or I'm getting into context corner.
I was actually, Jared, do you want to get started with like the where you can watch it, all the stars, all that other shit? Let's break down the fucking statistics so we can get right into the meat of it.
All right, today's film is titled Hereditary. It was originally released on June 8th, 2018. It is available to stream on Max. Just Max.
Mm-hmm. The place to go for HBO?
Yeah.
That one.
The thing that...
HBO's on there.
That's true.
The thing that even Conan O'Brien went on a rant on his infamous Hot Ones episode where he's like, it was called HBO, and now it's just called Max, because that's easier to remember for some reason. That's the film stars Toni Collette, Millie Shapiro, Alex Wolff, and Gabriel Byrne. Wonderful.
Toni Collette's the fucking goat.
Toni Collette, man.
What was Wolf? What was this?
Alex Wolf.
Alex Wolf, also incredible.
Yeah, fantastic in this movie.
No one's slacking in this movie.
I've got some shit to say after this is all done, specifically about Alex, but continue.
The official synopsis is a grieving family is haunted by tragic and disturbing experiences.
Sure.
Yeah, that happens.
It's vague.
That
big enough.
Exactly. That tells you just enough to not really do anything.
Yeah.
The film was written and directed by Ari Aster. It was his first feature film. Now, he had done several short films before this. Did anybody on the pod, because I sent it to both of you, just in case you wanted to watch it, did anybody watch The Strange Thing About the Johnsons or Munchausen's?
I watched both of them today on my lunch break.
I apologize.
It was okay. Like, I mean, you should apologize because I didn't have internet in my office. So I had to like go in the middle of my office, like to get on Wi-Fi and just had to like sneak into like an
I was going to say, please tell me your coworkers couldn't see.
No, nobody could see. Nobody could hear. But like my eyes were very open. And nobody asked me why. So it worked out great. Those are very, very interesting. Yeah. Did you see him?
I'm very unprepared for this show.
Oh, that's okay.
Unfortunately, I mean, I did lament to you maybe 20 minutes ago about how free time is fleeting for me now.
Yeah.
I know I have not watched either.
That's okay.
But I mean, like I've seen all of Ari Aster's film work, and I have watched a couple of the movies and shorts that has inspired him. So I feel like I understand the man. Right.
He constantly in interviews points to the cook, the thief, his wife, and their lover. I think I'm slightly getting the title a little wrong. But that was his biggest inspiration for this film because he wanted it to be a melodrama just about like regular people.
Yeah.
And then something incredibly odd and bizarre happens. And I think Carrie was his other big influence.
Oh,
Brian De Palma film.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can see that.
But regarding his short films, the strange thing about the Johnsons, they're all available to watch on YouTube for free if you guys want to check them out if you're listening. But content warning, the strange thing about the Johnsons is very upsetting and not safe for work.
No, it's not.
And so if you don't want to know, skip ahead in the next 30 seconds. But it is about a son that is sexually abusing his father.
Yeah.
It's that's rough. Heavy metal, dude.
Yeah. Like I've heard that in advance of watching it, but mm-hmm. like, not that it was about a son abusing his father.
I just knew it was about incest.
Just incest, father, son. So, you know, I just thought about it the way that
you think
I tended to hear about it,
sure.
You know, with like, you know, the power dynamic and stuff, but no, it's wild. Yeah. It's well acted. You can absolutely see the relationship between this and Hereditary being family right. drama, but
and it's well shot and everything. Mm-hmm. That movie apparently, or the short film, it went viral years ago on World Star.
That's crazy.
And so Ari for a while was known as like the guy that made that crazy like incest movie. yeah.
There's kind of a similar plot point in Euphoria.
Really?
Oh,
have you watched it?
I think.
Yeah.
I think
wait. Hold on. Yeah. I've seen it. There's only two seasons.
Because they won't do a third one.
Because
the other show that Sam whatever his name did.
Oh, with The Weekend.
Yeah, with The Weekend.
It was abysmal.
Yeah.
And that guy's I don't know about that one.
Yeah. Oh, it's really bad.
The guy that creates that show, like, he's apparently like super creepy.
He's a fucking weirdo. Yeah.
Yeah. Really?
But anyways, not to ruin the show, but like one of the main guys. Finds out that his dad has been cheating on his mom for, you know, decades with mm-hmm. men, and some of them not of age. And mm-hmm. like, so because he found this, he grew up really trying to like fuck with his dad. Like, I've got this secret, or I know your secret. So like, I kind of have power over you. It's close.
Yeah.
And he does have like nightmares of his dad, like sexually assaulting him, but it's never really confirmed whether or not that happened in the show, but like it's just what you just described kind of reminded me of that plot point.
Right.
No, it's like, I mean, yeah, it is about a power dynamic, but it is about the son sexually abusing his dad.
That's crazy, dude.
And gaslighting him
about it and shit too.
What? Yeah, yeah.
No, it's great. Yeah. It honestly does a lot with its premise.
That's tight.
It's upsetting though.
I gotta
it's
watch
incredibly
it.
Upsetting.
Uh-huh. I mean, yeah, we told you, I guess, like the gist. I don't know. Should we?
No, it's okay. We got enough to talk about
this movie.
Yeah.
Munchausen, really quick though, is about it's like much shorter. Mm-hmm. And it's just about a mom not ready for her son to leave home and go to college.
Sure.
And so she starts like slowly poisoning him and killing him.
there's like two things. Like that's like the Gypsy Rose thing.
Yeah. That's Munchausen by proxy.
Yeah. Hold on. There's a movie that is just like that, but with a daughter, not a son. And the mom has been slowly poisoning her daughter. To keep her in the house.
I mean, that's been a phenomenon.
That's crazy.
That happens in The Sixth Sense too, I remember.
Oh, yeah.
To make like a Toni Collette connection.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Oh,
there you go. Yeah. Toni Collette's the mom.
Haley Joel Osment's mom in that.
I totally forgot.
I'd never seen that movie until like 2 years ago during the pandemic. I'm dead serious. I've never seen that movie. I've known about it. I've known the.
Is that why you hate M. Night Shyamalan?
No, that's not the reason why I hate M. Night Shyamalan. I dislike him for many reasons. That movie is actually pretty good, but when we were watching it, it was like, oh fuck, it's Toni Collette, she's the best, and she was great in that movie too.
That scene where they're in the car in traffic and
that's the scene
she's like complaining, yeah, she's like, what's going on? She's like, there's a girl was hit and on a bicycle, and he goes, and he's coming forward to his mom about his condition, that he sees ghosts, and he tells her, he's like, mom, I'm ready to tell you now, like I see dead people, like I talk with grandma sometimes.
Yeah.
And you can tell like Toni Collette is like ready to be accepting, but she's really freaked out about it. And he says like, grandma wanted me to tell you something. And she said, you asked her a question at her grave one day. And she said, her answer is every day. And they both start crying. And he goes like, what was the question? What did you ask her? And she starts bawling, and she's like, I asked her if she was proud of me. And they just embrace. So good.
Toni Collette is an underrated.
She's the fucking bomb
powerhouse.
Man.
She's so good.
She was incredible.
Yeah.
Like I associated her before this with like comedies.
No, she prefers to do comedies.
Yeah, yeah.
She even states
what comedy is she in?
Well, she's in the recent Knives Out.
Oh, I mean, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
But like before that though, like the Coen brothers comedies like Fargo, Burn After Reading, we haven't seen those. Oh, man.
Baby, this man showed me Martyrs at an early age, and I haven't been able to
read an early age.
I haven't like seen it, but it sounds bad.
It's really good. Steven, if you like this movie, you're
I don't know if Steven is up for that. Even I don't want to subject him to that.
Okay. I don't know. I would say this movie's made me braver. I think I'm more willing to give stuff a shot.
Because I wouldn't show this movie to just anybody.
No, I wouldn't either. Oh, yeah, but about Munchausen, though, it does feel different in a way. It is like totally nonverbal. Like everything's conveyed.
That's right. It's all score. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like it kind of feels like
it's all show, don't tell.
It's all show, don't tell.
Oh, right? Hell
like
yeah.
The entire thing. But like it starts off feeling like a Pixar short. Yeah. Yeah. Like where you
it's
know,
very much like superficially like posed and framed like
yeah,
that.
Yeah. Like sweet music. And it's a bunch of like cute transitions where you're seeing a mom, like imagining like the life that her son's about to have, like going off to college, and it's exciting.
Yeah. The first half is just her imagining his life.
And it seems nice. Like it seems like she's thinking about it in a nice way, but then it'll like go back to her at home. And like, you can see like the biggest thing that I would compare this to Hereditary for is like the use of color, like the way like there's like very lively spaces and very dead looking spaces, even in like daylight. Like you absolutely get that sense in it. I don't know, like music is totally different. Like there's a lot of elements of, I guess, Hereditary and what came after that, you know, obviously he developed.
Have you watched Beau's Afraid?
I have not.
I was just going to say, so after Hereditary, Ari would go on to do Midsommar, as we mentioned, and Beau Was Afraid. We have covered Beau Was Afraid on the show.
Yeah, we're going to have to eventually hit Midsommar.
Yeah, 100%. And I have my A24 like collector's edition of it that I need to like really just rip into. Finally.
So does Haley.
Oh, yeah.
We watched it right. Like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
It was great.
Great movies.
Yeah.
God. Even Beau Was Afraid.
Yeah, no, it's a fantastic movie. Absolutely. Yeah. It made my top 10.
Not for everybody, but it was great.
For films last year.
Of last year.
Yeah, yeah. I heard it made your top 10. I'm excited to watch it now.
You should, especially if you like the show don't tell thing, because he does that a lot in that film. Mm-hmm. That film is like all context. It's very good.
Hereditary had a budget of $10 million.
What?
Isn't that the things he did with that amount of money?
Yeah.
It grossed $82 million at the box office.
Oh, hell yeah.
And at the time, it made it A24's highest grossing film until Everything Everywhere All at Once came out and took the crown in 2022, and it grossed $143 million. But that had a much bigger budget.
Right.
Yeah.
On Rotten Tomatoes, Hereditary holds a 90% critic score and a 70% audience score.
Boo. People are fucking stupid.
I don't get it.
It's your average Joe going in there being like, man, this is fucking stupid.
Okay.
You know, and then shitting on it.
Well, I don't see people saying it's not scary either. Like I heard that some people feel that criticism and I don't see it.
This movie is for a type of person.
Yeah.
The sicko.
And I like to think of our podcast as somewhat of a populist podcast. I want our podcast to be for the people, by the people.
Sure.
Or the working Joes.
Sure. Yeah. And then we'll go around and fucking trash Rebel Moon.
Okay. No. For the regular people, working for the people deserve good movies, not garbage just like Rebel Moon.
Okay.
Zack Snyder thinks he is... Transformers, Michael Bay, but he is not. Okay. Anyway, I digress. Wow. That's a different rant.
It's okay. Michael Bay also sucks.
He's
at least more of an artist.
Yeah. Sure.
He still made The Rock.
Yeah.
He made Armageddon.
I know.
You know, like.
Oh, I know. I get it.
Did you ever see that that YouTube channel, Every Frame of Painting?
Yes.
Yeah. And he had like that Bayhem episode, which he wasn't necessarily complimentary of Michael Bay, but it was very interesting to see like the breakdown of of his stylistic choices.
Hey, listen, we did Pain and Gain.
We did do Pain and Gain, but here's the funny the thing. I'm sorry. I don't mean to diverge us from us, but my son asked to watch the Bumblebee movie we don't have access to it right now. So I was like, all right, well, I'll put on a fucking a Transformers movie, whatever, right? And we put on the second one with the or yes, it is the second one with the little racist robots. The one that was like voiced by SpongeBob. And like I'm 5 minutes into this movie. I'm like, God, Michael Bay is fucking awful as a director. He's just so shitty. And my kid lost interest in 20 minutes in.
All right.
But that's because Bumblebee wasn't on the screen immediately. And also the Bumblebee film is significantly better.
It is.
Well, he didn't even do that one.
I think he
just produced it at most. So yeah, this film is divisive among people because a lot of people go to a horror movie and just want like your James Wan
jump
scare thing. Yeah. Right. And this movie isn't that. It's a slow burn. Mm-hmm. And it is like 80% like family melodrama, like I said, and then 20% like supernatural horror. Mm-hmm. But it takes its time. And a lot of people can't stand that. And I get it. That's fine. Sure. It's not for everybody, you know? And I think that's why there's such a divide here. But like we mentioned earlier, we had bad theater experiences the first time we saw it.
We did.
Because of that divide.
I don't know about that. Because you had somebody stood up and said, what, that was fucking stupid, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was the lady.
There were people giggling.
Yeah. We did have a lot of that. Like
there was a teenager fucking with his friends going the whole movie.
That's really annoying.
Yeah. Oh, Steven.
But then the movie kept doing it, and I wasn't sure when he was doing it and when the movie was doing
it. That makes the movie worse. That really sucks.
That happened in my theater too, but nobody stood up and said that sucked. But the lady right next to me, every time something happened, she'd go,
which I guess is preferable. Were they like
fucking annoying? No, Steven, she was being genuinely surprised by fucking
everything. She was there for a good time.
I mean, I could see it being annoying.
The light would be turned on and she would fucking gasp. I wanted to kill her, Steven.
I wanted
to kill her. Oh, I was so mad.
All right.
I was really enjoying the movie.
I had a worse experience during It Comes at Night.
Oh, I know.
And I think my theater was ready to like riot against that movie by the end of it. Yeah. And I remember looking at my wife and being like, I liked it.
Yeah,
she's like, yeah, I did too.
It Comes at Night was great. I also got the in your theaters, someone was like, Joey, you're not allowed to pick movies anymore. Yeah. Or something like that, right?
Yep.
The people in front of us, when we got up, the guy said, man, that really fucking sucked. And I point blank was like, are you serious? And didn't say anything to me.
Yeah.
Even when I saw Talk to Me, we came out. It was me, Haley, and four other people, like a mom and a daughter, and then like an older couple. And I was like, at the end, we all walked out at the same time. I was like, what did you guys think? And like the mom and daughter were like, oh, it was really good. And the older couple was like, eh, that was not for me. I'm like, oh, just fucking leave then.
I mean,
bye.
All right. Well, like,
what were they expecting? That movie is very honest.
Yeah.
Both in its marketing and in its promotion.
I don't know, dude. I don't fucking know, man.
Well, like speaking of promotion, like, I mean, is there a quality of, like, I feel like the ads for Hereditary were good and at least conveyed the dread. But I know, I think they did a really, really good job misdirecting your expectations. Like it was, but I don't know if people were just expecting a harder hitting horror with like the clicks and expecting like a more traditional horror movie of a sort.
I think so.
I think the problem is you're absolutely right about the promotion for it, because it does the constant like clicking that the girl does in the commercial that like slowly gets more common is that repetitive, building up dread of like a crescendo of what happens at the end of the film, right?
Yeah.
It is more honest than I would say something like Lamb.
Okay.
Right. That was what it was called, like Lamb, right?
I've actually not seen it.
I know you haven't. I've heard
the synopsis of it.
Lamb was billed as a scary fucking horror movie. It is not that. Mm-hmm. It's not even close to that. Oh, yeah. Like the stuff that's in the trailer are the stuff that happens at the beginning and the end of the film, but not in the center.
Mm-hmm.
I will say too, It Comes at Night had some deceptive marketing.
Sure.
It was built scarier than it actually was.
They had to put fucking butts in seats in A24.
Yeah, like
they've really leaned into grounded horror, rooted horror.
Yeah.
And that's something that I prefer. I don't like jump scares. Jump scares are fucking stupid. You're not giving me anything like worth watching. It doesn't have more to it. This genre of horror film is just so much more to bite on. It's like a juicy steak, man. You don't want it to end.
Yeah.
I think a jump scare can be earned, but like it can't be arbitrary.
No. Yeah.
Because honestly, there are kind of a couple in this movie.
Yeah.
But like it's not to the point where it feels unearned, like we were saying, you know. Mm-hmm. But also, this was like the same year, if not very close to The Witch or The Vivitch, which had a similar reaction. A lot of people hated that movie. In fact, I don't think I even liked that movie the first time I watched it.
Mm-hmm. I loved it.
I remember, I think we actually watched it with you, Steven, and maybe your brother, Aaron. And I remember we were all just kind of, it was okay. I don't see the hype, though. And then I remember watching it again later and being like, oh, no, this is a movie you have to like watch alone, not like it with a group at a house, you know, yeah. Like you have to like turn all the lights out and like be in the mood for it, you know.
I didn't know shit about that film. Haley yeah. dragged me. It's like, it's a movie about a witch. I was like, oh, yeah. Okay, sure, whatever. And when they mulched the baby at the beginning of the film, I was like, mm-hmm. yo, this shit is fucking weird and I'm so into it.
I don't know how I missed that. I don't know. Maybe I missed that was going on. But like, I don't know how I did. But well, like, I knew something bad happened and I knew it wasn't good.
Steven, I do think when we watched it that first time, I think it was like a really shitty rip, honestly, like a pirate copy. Right. And so I don't think we could see a lot of what was happening.
Yeah, I don't do that.
No, we're all grown adults with jobs and we can afford our movies
yeah,
now.
But. Yeah, and morally, I think they deserve the money.
Yeah.
But
saying that as someone who owns like hundreds of movies, like I don't feel bad about like my pirating days because I have put so much more money in back into the industry.
Yeah, but yeah. We've paid our dues. I feel okay about it. Yeah.
you're also one of my few friends with a DVD collection. So
yeah, no, I definitely back in the day, me and my brother, we went to the gym, but a lot of times when we say we're going to the gym, we're going to FYE buying cheap DVDs.
Oh yeah,
the Witch came out in 2015. Three years before.
I was way off. Yeah. Okay.
I think that.
But this movie is in conversation with that because it was like early A24, like
horror movies,
trauma horror.
Mm-hmm. And also, I think the big thing about against this one was like, I want to say that Blumhouse was having its like big push,
doing the complete opposite kind of
movie. Constantly shitting out garbage horror films. And I think that's like, that's why people were expecting it. It is what it is. Mm-hmm. I think that the 70% is wrong.
Yeah, I agree. It feels, you know, embarrassingly low, but that's what are you going to do? So Ed Potten of The Times wrote in his review of Hereditary, Ari Aster's superb psychological horror plays on one of the most powerful fears of all, the fear of turning into your parents. In her review of Hereditary for the Tribune News Service, film critic Katie Walsh said, where other actresses would play a single note, Colette plays a symphony of emotions. She will nearly bring you to tears and then make you laugh before you know it. Academy Awards don't feel like enough of a plaudit for this kind of performance.
Agreed. And she got fucking snubbed. And this is why I don't give a shit about the Oscars.
It's fair because they ignore genre movies like this.
It's fucked up.
Yeah. I can't think of the last time. Like, I know, I'm sure we can like look at whatever, IMDb or something. But I know like there has been horror movies that have won Oscars, but I feel like it's been a while.
It's few and far between.
Yeah.
They typically just ignore genre films, especially horror.
They don't give a shit about these new movies anyways, like these A24 films. Like, I know everything,
but it's not a genre movie.
Yeah, it's not. Yeah. But like, and I know that, what was it? The one that had Steven Yeun in it, Minari, sorry. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Minari won stuff too.
Oh, that's pure family drama too. It's Oscar baity almost.
Right. Yeah. But like, motherfucker, dude, how could they have not considered Toni Collette? As that person just said, a symphony of emotions. She's fantastic in this film. She sells this film.
Yeah.
Oh, she's incredible. Yeah, like she's such a strong actor. Yeah. Not enough can be said about her.
Yeah. 100%. Over on Letterboxd, user Beck gave the film 4 stars and wrote, if anyone ever clicks their tongue around me again, I am calling the police. So a couple of quick things before we get deep into the movie. According to Ari Aster, with Hereditary, he wanted to make a film about the corrosive effects of trauma on a family. And he also wanted to make a film that had sort of an Ouroboros quality about a family that's eating itself in grief. Ultimately, Hereditary is a film that was seriously tackling these issues and operating almost as a meditation on these things, while at the same time functioning as an exciting genre film.
Yeah, you know what that Ouroboros is?
It's like the snake eating its tail.
Correct. 100%.
Just consuming itself, yeah.
Correct amount.
It's a entropy made manifest.
Do we want to cover the film beat by beat?
No.
I have it in front of me, if so.
Not unless you want to.
I mean, I don't know. Hold on.
You literally do have it in front of you. Is that a book that's about Hereditary?
Oh, yeah. It's a beautiful book.
So, listener, I have in front of me.
I didn't catch that until right now.
Did you not know I own this?
I didn't know you own that. You
need to get a good look at the cover.
Courtney bought this for me a couple years ago. I have in front of me a special edition book that A24 put out for Hereditary, and it is a large coffee table sized book with a green hardcover, and it's embossed with the title Hereditary, and then Ari Aster, written and directed by Ari Aster, and then it has a shot from the film over the top of it of the treehouse scene.
Yes.
Where Toni Collette's body is floating up into sight of it.
That garnered many laughs in my fucking theater.
Oh, God.
Yeah, I fucking hate the general audience. I'm sorry, you want to be proletariat and same here, but like some people don't fucking
deserve it. I can understand like laughing like a what the fuck.
Yes,
like, nervous
laughter.
Sure.
Like that, because I did that in our IMAX screening the other day, and I felt bad because I don't think anyone else was, but maybe it was so loud that
I think you can tell the context of the laughter. You can tell like,
because even when the creepy cult guy is in the corner smiling back at Alex in the doorway. I kind of like do a nervous giggle because it's like, what else are you going to do? You
know? Yeah, it's like, holy shit.
By the way, that guy, he's the guy that smiles at Charlie in the funeral in the beginning.
Yeah. When we get further into this, I try to pay really close attention to where they show up elsewhere in the film.
Did you watch it a second time?
Yeah, I try to pay a lot of attention and I try to, in preparation for this podcast, to listen to a lot of other podcasts. But I try to validate some of the things they said, and I couldn't validate some of the claims. But yeah, allegedly, like these other – the cultists appear all throughout the movie.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I've got a few more I'll tell you about. But really quickly, let me finish about this book.
Yeah, sorry.
A24 put out this book about Hereditary. It's a beautiful coffee table
book. Yeah, it looks gorgeous.
It's the entire script, which has a lot of it's not the shooting script. Like, it is a script that has, like, Ari's original – writing.
So cool.
And so there's stuff in here that was cut.
Yeah.
And in fact, when I was watching the deleted scenes later, I was like, oh, they actually filmed some of these scenes that are in the script. The film was originally set during winter, so it's supposed to be snowing outside the whole time. All of that's in the original script. There's also the not the storyboards, but like what they were shooting day by day.
Yeah.
I forget what that's called, but Ari has that in here with his notes because he like meticulously plotted out what he was going to do every day so that he wouldn't go off track, you know, off schedule. And has like, you know, pictures of like, we're shooting this on this day and this scene on this day. It's wonderful. There's a foreword by Bong Joon-ho. And in the back, there is an essay by a writer who just happened to catch the film randomly in a hotel room one day while on a book tour.
Yeah.
And it just devastated her because her mom had recently died and she was raising a baby daughter.
Yikes. Yeah.
It's a great little essay. I love this book dearly. It is so wonderful. I'm so glad I own this. It is a prized possession of mine.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was meticulously poring over it in preparation for this episode. So do we want to get into like some tidbits about the movie?
I mean, like tidbits and it's like fun facts.
Yeah. So like, fun facts are good. Like the occultists. So one of Peter's friends that he smokes weed with is also one of the occultists.
So I try to verify that.
Yeah, he's the guy with the man bun at the end in the treehouse.
Oh, okay. Yep. His hair was different. Oh, wait, no.
He has long hair and a bun.
Is he the one in the scene where they're smoking weed and he has like the tuxedo shirt?
Oh, maybe. Because when they're under the bleachers and he has a panic attack, he's the guy, he's on the left.
Yeah, him.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it's that guy. Yep.
Okay. Well, all right.
Yep.
Yeah. I thought I heard somebody say he was also like wearing like the sigil, but I like looked really hard in that scene and I couldn't see the sigil.
That I don't recall.
Guys, you're blowing my fucking mind because I didn't even know this. Yeah. I've seen this movie like five fucking times and
Ari hid so much like foreshadowing.
I get really fucking lost in this movie, to be honest with you.
No, like, I understand.
The performances specifically by Toni and Alex are like really, really well done.
Yeah.
So I didn't fucking catch that. The only thing that I ever caught was the Paimon symbols, like the whatever those hatches.
The necklaces.
Were front and center almost.
Yeah. He was definitely shown, obviously, to like.
There's a good amount of them.
And then the lady, who
Joan.
Yes, that was like.
Yeah.
Those are the only things that I caught like at the beginning of the film that kind of kept carrying over. I never really like thought about any of the other ancillary actors. Yeah. You know, I never thought about
that. From the beginning of the film, there's so much foreshadowing.
Is there? That's crazy.
Well, like, wonderful. It makes a rewatch like so fun.
People in the funeral are like, whenever she's like,
there's a lot of new faces here.
Yeah.
It's because they're all the cult. Yeah.
Exactly. Oh, those are a lot of them. But like, you know, people are used, obviously they're waving across the street at, you know, the children. And I thought maybe a teacher, but I wasn't sure.
I don't know about that. But I know that one of the... In Peter's class, they keep talking about, I don't remember what the story was, but they're talking
Heracles.
About, oh, is it? Oh, okay. And it's about how he's doomed by fate. Mm-hmm. And they're like, is that more tragic than if he were to suffer from his own consequences or because it was like determined to be like this?
Yeah.
And in the original script, Peter isn't paying attention because he's staring at the girl and he gets called on to answer. And he like is riffing off of another guy by saying like, because he like had sex with his mom or something. And he's like, okay, Peter, clearly not paying attention. But it's like, and that, but that's like foreshadowing like what's going to happen in the movie too. Yeah. Basically, not having sex with his mom, but like he's determined by fate to like be doomed.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah. So like, yeah, that's, it's like, this is a, it is a tragedy in the classic sense.
Well,
like,
now, is he doomed or is he going to have like live the high life? Because he is the vessel of a demon of greed.
Well, it's Charlie who's in the vessel.
Well, yeah, but.
I guess
the whole family's doomed. It's the cult that's gonna reap the rewards.
The soul to him. It's the thing at the end.
All right, sorry.
He got driven out. He's done. Peter's gone.
No. Dude, yeah, he's yeah. Oh, I mean, I don't know if this is just jumping ahead too far.
Wait, you're fine. Hold on, you really think that? Because
the
scene where Joan is yelling across the street at Peter.
Yes.
She's saying like magic words and
I drive Peter, you, I cast you out.
I cast you out. Peter, get out.
Yeah.
Like leave the vessel.
Sorry, you're right. His soul is gone. That's right. You're right. You're right. Yeah. I'm sorry. You can't have two in there. That's bad. But hey, Paimon's gonna have a great time.
He's
in a great looking body. He's young. He's gonna have all the wealth. It's gonna be great, dude.
Speaking of that,
hey Peter, you gotta get the fuck out. I forgot about that.
Paimon is one of the eight kings of hell, master of infernal ceremonies, great king of hell, Lucifer's most obedient, demon of love and
got him,
demon of love and chaos, the pale king, a fallen angel that sided with Lucifer in the Old Testament and is mentioned in several major demonology books that are hundreds of years old, some even dating back to the 1500s. Much of the occult symbols and language used in the film is real, only some have been slightly altered so as not to be, you know...
So they don't do a real...
Yeah, they don't do a real... Alex Wolf doesn't turn into a fucking greed demon.
Exactly. So yeah, Ari did a lot of research on the occult and Paimon specifically, because he thought Lucifer was overdone. He's like, what if I did like a more obscure demon?
Yeah.
And then he said, since the movie's come out, of cultists have come up to him and been, or people who study demonology and are like, come on, Paimon, that's not original. But he did so much research that like it freaked him out.
Hipster demonologist. Yes.
That's great. You know, Paimon's also a little character in Genshin Impact.
I did actually find that while researching this.
I don't play the game, but it's this little like floaty fairy thing.
Right. And apparently the fact that it's named Paimon is actually foreshadowing something that happens later with it. I don't know anything about Genshin story.
I know one of the alterations was like, you know, the main sigil we see everywhere.
Yes.
It looks like there's like three figures like in there, and like the original symbol has four.
It's four, exactly. Yeah,
like Jared's over there throwing the numbers up.
So he changed some stuff around so as not to be infringing on the actual stuff. Yeah.
I'm afraid.
Even the words that we see like inscribed on the walls kind of off to the side, those are all real. I think it's Latin. And they are invocation spells because the occult, by the way, it's hinted at in the movie, but it's even more apparent in the script because they didn't like, they cut some of the scenes, but like the cult members are in the house the whole movie. The whole movie.
Yeah. Oh, what?
Yes. Yeah.
The whole, they're just hanging out?
Yeah. There's a scene very early on where the family comes home and they're all walking in the door.
Yeah.
What didn't make the final cut of the film is you hear footsteps in the house shuffling and the dog starts freaking out.
Bro,
and then everyone walks in.
Fucking cool.
Yeah. Well, like, and that's why like Steve, the dad, is like constantly upset because he sees footprints and he's like, oh, see, this is why we take our shoes off here.
Yeah. Yeah. So it made it a little less obvious, but like the more obvious things are like doors are open that shouldn't be open. Like they keep closing like grandma's old door.
Yeah. And he has to lock it. Yeah.
But like, I heard some other podcasts talk about like either stuff being rearranged or messed with. I mean, obviously words are written on walls.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which you could just say is a demon, but I don't know. I guess it's, you know, people. So
it's pretty badass. I didn't catch this shit. And I've watched this movie so many times. Yeah.
Speaking of a dog, like I like a lot of the stuff I heard was like people just did not know there was a dog in the movie.
Just
simply missing because it's, I guess, kind of forgettable. But
yeah, you only see it in a couple of scenes, but then it's clearly like dead at the end too because they intentionally pan over to show the dog is dead. Yeah. Yeah.
So, the dog always dies, dude.
Of course, yeah.
So I want you to explain to me, Jared, because yes. I know that you listen to, or you've read a bunch of stuff, and maybe even
Steven, podcasts you listen to. I'm impressed. Yeah.
Thanks.
I never prep for any of these things. I watch the movie and then I, just kind of regurgitate
it's good to have that dynamic, I think.
I agree.
I actually think you're right. Anyways.
Because if I tell Will something he already knows, he kind of yeahs me, and I'm like, okay, but the listener needs to.
Yeah. This is true. This is true. Oh. But anyways, did either of your research bring up any kind of admittance that Ari Aster had some sort of no?
Absolutely not.
Like no. Family issues or whatever.
So the reason why I say this is because of Beau is Afraid.
Which I have not seen.
Well, I know you haven't seen that, but that's what I'm like. That's why I'm bringing it up. Right? Yeah. So nothing.
No, in fact, he got asked it 1,000 times while promoting this movie. Sure. And God knows he did it during Beau's Afraid.
Too. Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
And he can't keep running from this because almost every single one of his movies, even his short films, have a mom or some family member dying or being killed.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, bro.
Something's happening at home.
But yeah, he got asked all the time while running, this movie around. Is everything okay at home? Like, what was your childhood like? Like, that kind of stuff. Like, is this a personal film? And he's like, no. He swears it's not.
I don't fucking believe him.
I agree.
I don't fucking believe him. That's cat, dude.
I think, okay.
Well, he can't have all these issues in all these movies, right?
But sure, surely he can't. No, he can't. That's the fucking thing, though. You've listened to our Beau is Afraid episode?
No.
Okay.
Let's not spoil the movie.
No. Go watch that film.
Thank you.
Yeah, I was like, go watch that film and then come back to me and tell me that fucking Ari Aster doesn't have problems with.
Oh, no. I am not saying he doesn't have any problems. No. But I don't know what all these movies have some kind of very distinct family issue that I don't know. Like, which ones are directly transferable to him.
And how much are him just, expounding researching on fantastically.
I'm sorry, but I can't help it. Zero in on grief. Mm-hmm. Tragedy mm-hmm. in a family. In this film, a mother is died. Her daughter is now having problems with that. Mm-hmm. And then she loses her daughter mm-hmm. and is having, even more. Like, grief drives this film.
Yeah.
Grief is the inciting factor mm-hmm. for our main character in Midsommar to go on this trip. Grief is the reason why, Beau, the parent's not lost. He's just non-existent. But the scar that is left by the absence of someone is also the driving factor.
It's his maternal relationship that is driving him insane and anxious, and holding him back.
Yeah, there's so much of the same fucking thing, and I wouldn't say that all three of these films are of the same note, but that one spark seems to I don't know.
It feels like a running thread.
It's his fucking muse, dude. Like grief is his fucking muse.
Yeah,
I don't know. He's got another movie coming out soon, doesn't he?
He does, but I don't really know anything about it, and I want to go into it cold,
so I probably
won't try to spoil myself beforehand.
Right, but I'm just saying, if we go to this fucking film and, parents die or whatever, or people are fucking sad throughout the entire film.
Or someone's mom is
I'm going to go to his house. I'm going to fucking, Ari, if you're listening, I'm going to fucking find Ari, you.
I will hug you. You need a hug,
yeah,
man.
It's true. It's true.
Well, let me say this. So,
okay.
I resonated with this film immensely on a number of levels. I was similarly experiencing a tense and strained relationship with my mother when I was a teenager. And incidentally, my mother is also a miniature artist, very similarly to Toni Collette's character in the film. The exquisite family drama that slowly unfolds and constricts over the course of the film was so immersive for me that I remember thinking after my first viewing in 2018, that is one of the greatest films I've ever seen, and I don't think I ever want to see it again. And the other night in IMAX, 6 years later, was the first time I saw it for the second time.
I remember you saying that, you haven't rewatched it.
I've been afraid to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I guess I should ask, what was y'all's experience for,
I'll tell fantastic. You right now, I was squirming in my seat.
Yeah.
And I'd already seen the movie. I knew what to expect. And I felt a little bad for Steven because I was worried I was, telegraphing projecting. Something was going to happen.
Yeah.
Because, right before Charlie's accident, I started, gripping the seat and tensing up.
They were making the tension pretty it was apparent that something was happening.
Something's gonna happen because she's already having a
shock.
Yeah,
it felt like it was time for something to happen. no but like it
I mean, I don't think you telegraphed too much, but like I said earlier, some stuff had been spoiled for me.
What stuff was spoiled for you?
Yeah, so my brother's in a metal band, and he likes to find images.
Shout out to Colin. And Swamp.
Go Swamp. Yeah, he had some like imagery from like horror movies on some of his promotional materials, and like he had the dad catching on fire
cool,
which is great. But like, and I heard somebody like see it, be like, oh, I love that scene or whatever, and then I heard him talk about it.
I gotcha.
So I was like expecting that to happen at some point. I wore a Smokey the Bear shirt to the movie theater because I knew that like was coming joke. Forward.
Yeah.
So yeah, nobody commented on it. It was really funny.
You had to point it out to me, and when I got it, I was like, oh shit, that's good.
Yeah, but you also didn't think I knew anything. And try to think of anything else. Like I just seen certain images because YouTube, like once it finds out the kind of person you are, it will just show you every image. Like out of context, like I did see the image of, and like I didn't understand what I was looking at, but the image of Charlie's decapitated head on the mannequin at the end and with the crown. Yeah. Like I saw that image but ahead of time, and then thankfully I wasn't expecting it because I just didn't understand what I was looking at, then I was like, oh, I've seen that. I had such a good time in the theater. Like the crowd was great, you know, people were reacting, but nobody was like
all 12 of us. Shout out to Trevor, by the way.
Shout out to Trevor,
the friend we made in there.
Really? Oh, that's right, you were telling me you made him. Yeah. And you even told him about that. Hey, you know what, shout out to Trevor,
he's probably listening because I told him about the podcast.
Shout out Jared, advertising for his podcast.
I even told him, like, I gotta get out of my comfort zone here, we have a podcast.
And I didn't include myself in that, Will, so it's like, don't feel I'm like stepping on your territory.
You could totally fucking replace me. Okay. That's okay.
Anyway, it was a great experience. The sound was incredible.
I'm sure.
Like,
I don't remember the last time I've actually seen a real IMAX screening, to be honest with you. Cause I was even kind of when it went from the previews to like the full movie and the screen opened up, I remember being like, oh shit, this is a lot bigger than I remember.
Yeah. I was going to say, how is the IMAX theater at, nice. Lakeland is good.
This was at the Cinemark Lakeside 18 CMX.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what it's called. And it's, I think they just have the one.
Yeah, they just
IMAX?
Have the one.
Just one IMAX theater.
It's nice.
That's cool. I didn't know.
It was humongous on the inside. Mm-hmm. Like the auditorium itself, I remember walking in and being like, God damn, this is huge.
The last time I saw an IMAX movie was The Force Awakens over at Mosey.
Oh.
Yeah. That's and before cool. that, it was.
Oh, in
was
Mosey,
that in
though?
The dome?
Yeah, it was in the dome.
How Dude. Much did that suck?
That was fucking cool as hell. Are you kidding really? Me? Yeah, it was cool as fuck.
Were you there?
You guys not like that?
We Jared Dark and I Rises. A while ago watched Dark Knight Rises there. Like I was really looking forward to it, but like, yeah, I found it distracting. I couldn't like take in the whole image, even though like in a way it did encapsulate your vision. Like I had to like turn my head to like look around and notice everything, and it was all distorted and messed up, and it didn't feel like the optimal viewing experience.
I think the only things that work on the dome are like those documentaries that are shot for the dome.
They're so cool.
But Dark Knight Rises, it was not a good experience. I was so disappointed.
The Force Awakens was fun, but the film that I saw before that in the dome was Speed Racer. Speed Racer was fucking insane.
I bet that was wild.
It was the final race. I think I almost died. It's kind of wild.
That movie is ready for like a reawakening or reappreciation.
Oh yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah. I think it's going to get like, I think the lead actor in it teased on Twitter that like it's getting a 4K re-release and like it's going to come back to theaters.
It's going to be so pretty.
We would probably have to cover it.
Oh, I'm like, down, dude. I'm down.
I want to see that.
Yeah, because even I didn't see it in theaters when it came out, and I remember being like, I don't know, the Wachowskis lost it. And then like I picked it up on Blu-ray years later and I was like, whoa.
Yeah. So it's funny. Fucked up. Brian pushed us to go see it. And he was like, no, you don't understand. This movie is fucking crazy. And like, just reminds me that final scene, man, with all the fucking lights and colors, like the right towards the end, like all of us were cackling. It was how ridiculous that film was. Yeah. But
it looked incredible. It's like the hard commitment to be an anime adaptation.
It's like psychedelic, like live action. Oh God, it's wild.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. But anyways, I was just curious how the Lakeland IMAX.
Honestly, I was impressed, and it's better than like Cinemark XD, which I do because like that's like their version of IMAX, but it's not quite as good.
I gotcha.
But no, the IMAX screen was huge. Like the format itself was so big. We actually kind of sat close too. Because, like, yeah. We sat in, like, the sixth row, I think it was.
Yeah, I think it was, like, you know, how there's, like, the middle separation. Like
yeah, it wasn't.
We were, like, in the first row down from the middle separation.
Yeah.
So
I think it was the sixth, because there was, like, at least four rows in front of us. And there was only one other person in front of us. Everyone else was way up behind us.
Yeah.
And even I remember sitting down and being, like, this is probably too close because most theaters I go to, like, that's perfectly fine.
Yeah.
But with the IMAX screen, I was like,
do you want to go all the way in the back? Is like the back the best part?
I almost think we should have gone further back. Yeah.
I was pretty happy with it. Well, also, I understand like the middle is also like where the sound is
that's
directed
where it
towards.
It tends to be calibrated.
Which I was absolutely noticing.
The sound was phenomenal.
Yeah. Did you hear every squelch of Toni Collette's neck as she fucking girded herself? Yeah.
Every squelch. The big thing that like I really noticed was like just the what do you call that the sub tones or
yeah because on the soundtrack there is like a
yes
that gets more like increasing with tension.
When I was watching it at home, like I just have a soundbar at home. I don't have a subwoofer or anything, but like I did not notice that or I kind of heard it, but like it just it's a whole other thing. Feel it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Where it becomes overpowering and you know it's to like freak you out.
It adds
to the tension, I assume.
It really does. That's good. It was very good.
Because it feels like a heartbeat, like an accelerated heartbeat, you know, and it's, oh, God, it's wonderful.
That's neat.
Yeah. What else? I remember it was a little too loud for me, but I have like sensory stuff in the theater sometimes. So, like,
you are also an audio guy. So, you
know. I am an audio guy. And
I've got a question for you. Because, once again, this is your first viewing. Do you have like a favorite scene or something that jumps out to you that is really memorable?
Yeah. As the newest person to this movie, absolutely.
Yeah. There's a lot of incredible stuff. Obviously, the last, like, what, 15, 20 minutes is incredible the whole time through. But before that, because I feel like the ending's like an obvious answer.
Yeah.
I think before that, the other big sequence would be the car accident scene, like where you're really dwelling on what's his name, Wolf's face?
Peter.
Well, it's not Alex, Peter Wolf, Alex but Wolf. It's
Alex Wolf.
Alex Wolf, but this character's Peter. Got it.
Yeah. Sorry.
That's all good. No, Peter Wolf is like a, you know, it's like that classic story, Peter and the Wolf.
Three Little Pigs.
I'll shut up. I'm
the Peter who cried wolf?
Peter who cried wolf, yeah. And no, Peter and the Wolf, there's like a Disney short with like flutes and shit.
The Fox and the Hound?
Okay, well, come on, let's go back, please. Please, let's
all
go
right,
back.
All right, so anyways.
You're talking about Alex Wolf's reaction.
Yeah, like his reaction to like having the accident.
Yeah, where he won't
just
even
like
look.
Winning on his face.
Yeah.
And he won't even look.
Yeah.
And like that felt like a very realistic reaction to like trauma and like even like, you know, his going home back. And like I can see people like criticizing or playing, you know, saying, oh yeah, you should have called the cops or done like no, it felt like a very, very earnest, like real, well acted version of that.
1000%. Because like in the moment you don't question it. But I was explaining this film to someone recently, and he's probably going to listen to this. And I was explaining what happens in that scene. And he's like, what the fuck? Why didn't he go to the hospital or call the police? And I'm like, dude, that no.
That would be logical.
Put yourself in his shoes. Like, he is freaked the fuck out.
Yeah.
You know, like, it makes sense in the context of the moment because he's so freaked out about it. He's stoned, number one.
Yes, there's that. You can't forget that.
Number two, like, what do you do?
He's
like,
the direct reason why his sister is dead.
It's all the Colt's fault, really. But
he doesn't even want to acknowledge it. He doesn't want to acknowledge it.
That's why
he won't even look at it. And when it goes into his point of view and he tries to look in the rearview mirror and then darts his eyes back down. And then, like, days later, he has a vision of him looking up and looking to a rearview mirror and then looking down again.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
It's so well done. If you remember the story of Heracles, this is fated to happen.
It's true. Yeah, wrong.
I mean, listen, the Colt symbol was on that telephone pole.
Yeah. They called their shot.
Yep.
Kobe.
Brilliant. So would you, Steven, if I were to tell you that 3 years later, Alex would give probably the worst performance of his life in a movie called The old? Would you believe me?
I believe it. Sure.
Do you know who directed Old?
I'm aware of M. Night Shyamalan's Old. I have not seen it. But
if you want to be really disappointed in Alex, go watch Old.
It
is mind boggling how he can go from this film to that film and fucking suck.
Yeah.
I'm so mad at you right now.
I haven't seen Old, so I can't speak to this, but I do feel like a director can have a big impact on an actor's performance. And I'm sure some actors can overcome that if they're maybe not with the best director, but I don't know. A lot of people like to talk about, what's his name? Anakin Skywalker.
Oh,
like him actually being a better actor.
He's not.
I don't want to pile on the guy. That poor dude does not deserve.
He doesn't deserve the hate. And I'm glad that he's getting a renaissance and people are, treating him with respect and whatnot. Yeah. But I will go out and say, no matter what, Ian Christensen's not a good actor. I hate to say it, but he's not.
I just haven't seen him in other stuff. I heard there's something Before that, I guess he was better in, but
no, he was in Goosebumps film.
I'm just saying shit. I'm just saying,
hey, what else is a podcast, man?
It's true. But Hayden Christensen had a film that came out after the prequels were done called Awake, where he's put under anesthesia, but his mind is awake while he's being surgically fucked with. And he was as stiff in that as he was in the prequels.
Huh.
Even when they brought him back for the Ahsoka show, it is very sad to go from Clone Wars voice actor Anakin Skywalker to him. He's trying his best to ape the voice actor, and he does not have the charisma for it. And I really, I feel bad. Hayden Christensen, not a good actor.
All right.
Now, what do you believe if I told you that the same year that Old came out, a movie called Pig came out that Alex was in, and Alex was significantly better than that? Isn't that weird?
Who is he in Pig?
He's the son of the guy who got the pig killed.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's right. Oh, well, that's
okay. Another beautiful movie.
I saw it. I just didn't think to look for Alex Wolff at that
point.
It's
okay. I just don't like Old.
Speaking. All right. We're done with the M. Night Shyamalan bashing. Okay.
Yeah.
Trap looks amazing. I can't wait. Okay.
No.
We're going to cover that on the show.
I think M. Night Shyamalan could be fun, when he leans into camp.
Yeah. The Visit was really good.
The Visit is so fun.
The Visit's fantastic.
I can't wait to see his daughter's movie, too. That movie looks pretty freaky. No,
I'm sure I'll end up watching him for the pod, but don't expect me to be praiseworthy.
Right. Mm-hmm. But Trap looks amazing. It's a great premise.
I don't believe it.
Listener, look up the trailer for Trap with Josh Hartnett.
I haven't seen it. It looks amazing. It's a vehicle for his daughter's music career.
Great.
Yeah.
Is it like trap music?
I don't know.
No. It's she's like a pop singer, but
I don't like him, Nigel.
Okay, I'm gonna
anymore.
All right, sorry.
The premise of Trap. Okay, you'll get it out of me. Okay, so the premise of Trap is Josh Hartnett has a 12-year-old daughter.
Yeah,
and he's taken her to this huge concert arena to see the biggest performance ever.
M. Night Shyamalan's daughter.
By this pop star. No, Josh Hartnett's daughter.
I know. M. Night Shyamalan's daughter is the pop star.
No, Josh Hartnett's daughter. In real life, is the pop star.
Oh, whatever.
Yeah. Josh, M. Night Shyamalan's daughter is a director who has her own movie coming out.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
I don't know. Fucking whatever.
This guy. Anyway, so this big pop diva is putting on this humongous concert, right? Josh Hartnett is taking his daughter. She's so excited. And he steps away for a minute from his seat to go to the bathroom. And he stops and asks a guy at one of the merch booths. He's hey, there's a lot of cops here. What's going on? And so the guy leans over and he's like, all right, I'm not supposed to tell anybody this, but do you know that guy, the butcher, the serial killer you hear about in the news that's killing everybody?
Oh, man.
Well, the police got a tip off that he's going to be here tonight. And so they're going to trap him here in the concert arena during this performance.
Okay.
And Josh Hartnett's face goes, oh, wow, that's crazy. And then he slowly gets a sinister frown. And then he walks away and pulls out his phone and he has a guy chained up in his basement that he's torturing. And so
that's a great twist.
Wow, what a twist.
I think what they're trying to say in the trailer is that Josh Hartnett is the butcher, but I think there is another twist within the movie.
The butcher is the guy in the basement.
That either something like that, or Josh Hartnett is also trying to catch him and has to escape in order to catch him. I don't know. I can't wait, though.
Look at me.
He's such a hater.
Yeah. He just made the jerk off motion.
I did.
Yeah.
All right. Moving on back to Hereditary.
Yeah.
A good movie.
Speaking of Alex Wolff and Ari Aster really got along. when Alex was signing on for the film, he read the script and he was like, this is incredible. I have to be in this. And he was coming hot off of Nickelodeon.
Yeah.
He was one of the guys in the Naked Jonas Brothers band.
Naked Brothers Band.
Naked Brothers Band. Thank you. So, I'm confusing Joe. Yeah, you're right.
I didn't know that.
Which
is an interesting
term. And he was like, I'm ready to do more adult contemporary stuff.
And he fucking did it.
Yeah. And he's apparently a big film nerd. And so he was reading this and talking with Ari about it and like making connections to other movies. Yeah. And Ari was like, yeah, you got this, man. You know what I'm doing here. So he signed on to it. Toni Collette she told her agent, I want to do more comedies, like lighthearted stuff. I'm tired of like serious dramas. Uh-huh. And then her agent forwards her the script for this. And she goes, oh, fuck off. I have to do this now.
I remember hearing about that. Yeah. Man, can you imagine what this film would be like without either of them?
Oh my God. Yeah.
It would suck.
The actress plays Charlie. I have Millie, her name. Millie Shapiro.
Yeah, there you go.
Mm-hmm. It's what an unfortunate surname. Yeah,
she's great
surname.
Too.
But she had just recently, before being cast in this film, had won a Tony for playing Matilda in a Broadway play of Matilda. And she's also amazing, even though the marketing makes her look like she's a big part of the film and she's only about a third of the movie.
She is.
She's a cameo. It's fine.
Yeah.
That's messing.
Yeah, she's... Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
What the miniatures, okay? Mm-hmm. The miniatures for this movie... painstakingly all handmade by real artists. The guys that made them spent so much time on them.
And then Tony fucking destroys
them. And then they literally destroy them on camera. Yeah.
Tony, we can only do this in one take, so like really go for it.
Exactly. Yeah. That had to be a nerve-wracking scene because it's like, Jesus. There's one miniature model in particular that's at the base of the stairs in the house, in the family home. And it's their home on top of two other homes that are like kind of buried and dilapidated.
Yeah.
So that was apparently one of her prize-winning miniature models from a prior contest.
Okay.
And it's supposed to represent, to me, this is my interpretation. I did not actually see this written anywhere. Mm-hmm. My interpretation of it is, like the film's name, it's about you succeeding your ancestors, you know, and like their ruins lying beneath you and buried.
Yeah, it's the buried past.
Yeah, exactly.
I think I sent you guys a link that was about, I guess, like the, whatever... group like made the miniatures.
Yes, I actually read through that. That's where I'm cobbling a lot of that knowledge from.
But yeah, I think like the styles of the homes are progressively more contemporary,
more antiquated
as they go further up.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
yep.
Yeah,
how they're older. Yeah.
Like how one dinosaur is older than another.
Yeah.
Like that.
I love that gag in cartoons. Yeah,
not wrong. There you go.
Yeah. I don't know if this is in your notes about the miniatures, but I understand that both the miniatures and the set itself of the house were made at the same time. And like they like heavily coordinated making the details match so that they could do like the crazy like match cuts
the intro shot.
Like that, for example, but also like just a lot of like sequences throughout the movie are miniatures and you don't even realize it.
They're scenes from the film too.
Yes.
And also the ending scene, it's stressed more in the script than I think actually made the final cut. But when it zooms out of the treehouse and shows the home and everything, it's supposed to do that tilt shift. Mm-hmm. So it looks like a miniature, even though it's not.
I
don't think they actually
see that
quite went for it in the movie, but it's in the script.
I can see it does look like a miniature at the end, I would say. Yeah. Like, I think that comes across.
Yeah. Also, all of the interiors for the home, which are most of the movie, soundstage, all built on a set.
Yeah.
They could not find a home that met all their criteria for shooting, so they decided to just build it on a set. And I think that saved them a lot of money probably too.
That's cool.
Well, they had to be able to remove walls to get a lot of those
weird
scenes.
Yeah. Exactly. It provided more flexibility and stuff, I'm sure. The exteriors was a home in Utah that they found. They shot everything in Utah. It was probably cheap there. I'm sure they had like tax incentives and stuff.
$10 million budget.
Yeah. They were. It's incredible what they were able to do with that. And also, so many of the effects were practical.
Did Toni Collette really cut her head off?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
You don't actually see it.
That's true. She did have like a fake like neck brace thing on.
Oh, that's fucking
like awesome. The way that the wire was bulging. Yeah. Right. Or like her flesh was bulging around the wire. It looked great.
She's really pulling a wire around like a false neck built around her
that's
while she's
fucking
doing that.
Brilliant. God damn. Yeah. I love this movie.
She really
so
filmed
much.
Herself too, but like upside down, obviously, like hammering her head on the attic door.
Yeah.
Because there's a clip of that in the documentary I watched. Yeah. God, she had so much fun. You
I
could
bet.
Tell doing that shit.
I bet she did. Didn't Alex actually smash his fucking head on the desk too?
So when Alex like gets possessed and like loses his mind in the classroom, he told Ari, he's like, I want to go all out for this. He's like, give me a real desk. I want to bash my face in on it.
Yeah.
And Ari was like, okay, no, we're not going to do that.
Baby boy, you're like 20. Don't mess your face up.
It's going to be cushioned. Okay.
Yeah.
But Alex fucking went for it still.
Yeah.
And like, even though it was cushioned, only part of the desk was cushioned. And he banged his jaw on the part that wasn't cushioned. Mm-hmm. And like fucked up his face.
Like it was just still hard underneath and he hit it hard enough.
That's what it was. Yeah. He hit it so hard that he still overdid it.
Yeah.
And he dislocated his jaw, which was a previous injury. So it was easy to like
reset.
Redo. Yeah. But also like when he got back to his trailer afterwards, he was thrashing about in his seat so much that he ended up like cutting open his leg and he didn't realize it. And there's a picture in the documentary of him like getting his leg bandaged up. And he's just like,
brilliant. Yeah. Fuck yeah. Let's go, dude. That's awesome.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I'm shocked that you didn't bring up the scene at the table, the kitchen table after Charlie.
Incredible scene. Goodness. Yeah, like another like the simmering resentment between everybody. Mm-hmm. Well, I guess not towards the dad.
The dad is like he's
dad's great.
Yeah, he's an unwitting.
He's trying to play peacemaker.
Exactly.
In the dad's performance, you can also see you don't know how much these personalities have grated on him in the past.
Sure. Yeah.
But like, actually he seems like sweeter before his kid's death, but the way he just like shuts up and he's like, he's holding back, but he can like tell it's like grating on him the whole time. And he's trying so hard to like
be stoic.
Escalate things.
Yes. Yeah.
He's trying to not be an escalator.
You want to know why? Did you pick up on this?
Please, Jerry, tell me. Cause I had no idea.
He's a psychologist. They cut all the scenes from the movie, but it's implied he's a doctor. He's a psychologist.
Okay, that makes
sense. In fact, something that didn't make the final cut of the film. So Toni Collette's character, Annie, is one of his former patients. Doesn't that really kind of fuck with the whole dynamic of the family too a little bit? Because when I found that, I was like, oh, fuck.
That's crazy.
That is interesting. Yeah. And it doesn't come off as weird to me while watching, but I understand he's like a good bit older than Toni Collette, right?
Like, I'm actually not sure. Like the actors themselves, I'm not certain. But I wonder if Ari cut that for a reason. Like if he doesn't want people reading into that sort of thing, you know?
Like don't focus on this.
Because Annie has her own problems because of her mother and her affiliations.
Right. I think cutting it makes it feel more like he's an unwitting participant in what's going on with the family.
Right. Right.
Because you give him more, if you give him more stuff to do or more background, it changes how I think the ending of the film exists, you know?
I will say too, there were, I watched all the deleted scenes and they're almost all just focusing on Peter just kind of falling apart and losing his mind and being depressed.
I think slamming his face on the desk sold that pretty well.
It's him being lucid, but like his dad comes and checks on him after the shouting match with his mom.
Yeah.
And he just breaks down crying saying, I want to die.
Wow.
And Toni Collette, it pans down to her in the bedroom listening to him crying and she starts crying too.
No, that actually would have been, they should have kept that. That's really cool.
That was the one scene I was like,
that's good.
I like this. There's another one too where it's at Charlie's funeral.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And Peter is like hiding in the back. Like he's looking through the stained glass window. Mm-hmm. Well, it follows him and he like just sneaks off to the bathroom and just like gets in the bathtub and is just running the water. And he's dialing his cell phone, his voicemail box on a cell phone and just listening to all the voicemails his mom left him that night saying like, hey, I'm just checking on you and Charlie to make sure you guys are okay.
Mm.
It's heartbreaking.
That's brutal. Oh, man. God damn it. Yeah. Those are really good.
I think the movie felt colder for not having some of those things, which I think might be to its benefit.
I think.
Yeah. And also, it's hereditary. Like he's not blood related to, you know, everyone else. So I don't know if it's again, outside of the focus of what Ari was going for.
Yeah, I think he's talking about the dad.
Yeah. The dad's not blood related to
the mother,
the grandma,
yes. Grandma, oh, yeah, mom, yeah. And then the kids. But then the dad
when
married
the kids
in.
Are his.
He's, yeah, yeah.
But he's just like, I mean, let's take a thing out of Beau's Afraid. He's just the donor, dude. He's just not important. The importance is what's going on here.
Say too, in the so someone pointed out that like the kids don't really look like their parents at all in this film.
Yeah,
and that's just a complete casting decision. Somebody asked it in a Reddit AMA and Ari was like, just hoping you wouldn't notice. You're not supposed to read into that at all.
Guys, the performances are really good. Just don't.
Exactly. It's like, I cast the actors based on their acting, not on their, resemblances to the other actors. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Like I kind of dwelled on a bit like, oh, is this from like, is Peter from a previous relationship or something like that? But it doesn't really matter.
No.
So
I have more. I'm just like,
no, yeah.
I don't have it in front of me, so it'll come to me as we go.
It's okay. There's so much to talk about.
There is a ton to talk about. I mean, like, if we did do a point by point, we'd be here for like 2 hours. Like, this film is a work of art. Yeah. Every frame a painting.
One of my favorite YouTube channels. Yeah. Although that guy, so he had to close the channel down because he ran out of time. Him and Tony Zhao and another person that he did it with, they got hired by the Criterion Channel.
Oh, so good
they,
for them.
They do like documentary stuff for the Criterion Channel now.
Well, I should look at that.
Yeah, it's excellent. It's great stuff. Yeah, he has a featurette on the Jackie Chan box set that I got.
I'm very interested to look into that now. Okay.
Cool. Yeah, but Every Frame of Painting, amazing YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. If you just want to pull up something and like get like a 10-minute like film school class, basically, you know, and it's so good.
But like there's no fat on this film. Everything's intense. Well, what is?
It is very long.
Who cares?
I know. It's not a complaint. It's just an observation.
Yeah.
That sigh with your voice kind of indicates otherwise.
I feel like it's a complaint, you know, and I feel bad saying it, you know, because like,
dude, I'm going to glaze up Ari. I don't give a fuck because he's earned it. I sat.
It's not that it's not
like
deserved.
I was entertained the whole way through. Like, I didn't feel bloated to me. I realize it's long, but I didn't feel bad to me.
Right. It's more earned. It's an intentional slow burn.
Yeah. Yeah.
I will say, glancing at the reviews from critics, like some of the negative reviews were pointing out that like it's dull and slow and nothing happens until the very last 5 minutes.
Sure.
And it's like. Okay, well, whatever.
You've just got fucking, you know, brain rot. So I will say, if you do end up watching Bo's Afraid, I will pinpoint the moment where you're sitting there and you're watching and like, fuck, this is going on a little too long.
Okay.
And it's unfortunately like one of the most artistic parts of the fucking movie.
I have a pretty good tolerance for long, beautiful sequences.
It is beautiful.
Could have been its own movie.
It could have been. But like, I remember in the theater being like, okay.
I remember being like, how the fuck is this the rest of the movie?
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'll watch it. I have good tolerance for that kind of thing.
You haven't listened to our episode on it yet.
Right? Yeah, I have.
No, good.
So there was a point during our experience in the theater where we realized we were alone in the theater finally. Like, the only other guy had left.
There was a couple that was sitting behind us. It was two people.
Yeah.
And yeah, I just so happened to glance over my shoulder and was like, oh, they're gone. It's like two and a half hours in. They're gone.
So we all go, oh my God, what the fuck about the movie, you know? Because we can like talk now.
Yeah.
It was so funny.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Well, I got it.
You do need to watch it, and it's not going to bother you. Like, I don't know if any of this movie like made you feel unsettled or bothered or anything.
I mean, like, it is unsettling, but like, again, I think I just worked myself up too much. I was just I felt impressed the whole way through. Like, I did have the sense of anxiety, like, and maybe if I had no context going in, maybe I would have felt more. But like, I felt like I was able to like I really was enjoying it the whole way through. And it was like, it was amazing. Like being surprised.
And when you watched Midsommar, you didn't have like an anxiety going into it either.
Some anxiety. Cause I knew Ari Aster did,
horror films.
Yeah, I did. I knew he did this. And I was having some anxiety cause like, I just didn't know what to expect. And, but like, I was again, pretty pleasantly surprised with it. I feel like the gore, I would say, is about on par in Midsommar.
Yeah.
Again, it has like a slightly lighter tone, but again, it deals with trauma.
Yeah.
That's his.
Well, I will say, Beau's Afraid is equally anxiety ridden as it is comedic, but it doesn't have true horror elements like the other two.
No, it's more of a like riveting dramedy. Mm-hmm. God, how do you fucking describe that movie? But there is,
I mean, how
there are some horror elements, though.
Yeah, there are, but not too many. I think you'd really like it.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh,
no,
yeah.
I
of all of our friends, Steven's gonna be like that.
All right.
Yeah, I can't wait to get the text message. Yo, you guys weren't fucking kidding.
No, I'm very interested.
Yeah.
I don't know. Are there any like other like major points you wanted to hit or like plot points that we want to discuss?
I'm rushing through my head.
Joni is great. Love her.
Amazing. Obviously, she has the embroidered welcome mat that matches Toni Collette's mom's welcome mats. That's no accident, obviously.
Right. Like the welcome mats were super interesting in terms of like just because like rewatching the ending and you learn a bit more about stuff about the cult. Like, was it like they pray to the Northwest or the Northeast?
Paimon is his home is located in the northwest.
The
so
northwest.
When you pray so, toward Paimon, you face the northwest.
So like on one of like the place, the, not a placemat, a doormat. Yeah. Like there's like a like a compass rose, but like the northwest is like it's like gold embroidered as opposed to white.
Good catch, Steven. God damn.
Yeah, no, it's like covered. Well, like Charlie's, which it doesn't say. Does it say Charles instead of Charlie?
Well, so Charlie was supposed to be. It needed to be a male.
That's what Grandma wanted.
Yeah, exactly.
But you know that didn't happen.
Right.
Also, Jones' grandson and son that drowned.
Uh huh.
She was trying to put Paimon in them.
They
too.
Were failed experiments. I totally.
All right. So, I guess maybe I don't know if we want to get into like this plot minutia, but like I am like kind of curious what. All right, if it wasn't Paimon that was doing the seance at Joan's place.
It was, because remember how she says, oh, you need a connection to the spirit you want to talk to. This was my grandson's chalkboard. No, she was buying it in the previous scene when she
I was looking for it in her too.
Car.
Okay, I didn't spot it, but I believe it.
When we saw it on IMAX, I noticed it because it's in the back of her car in the bag from the store.
A big thing and this is probably just cinema sense and stupid for me to think about, but like the separation between, is there like a separation between Charlie and Paimon? Like for example, like early in the movie, you see Charlie being influenced by the light to go look in a direction, like, you know, see the woman in front of the burning pit. And so like, you know, but you're like, but Charlie's Paimon, she would make these decisions, or like, it didn't feel like she was a conspirator to knock her own head off.
Hold on. As far as I know, it isn't the whole thing like, she's not a perfect vessel, so there's part of her that's still in there.
That's where I was going with that.
Okay.
Because Paimon is in her, but he's not fully ready to take over because it's not his preferred vessel. He wants a boy.
Okay.
That's why.
Well, like,
yeah.
All right. And like at the end, do they refer to...
That's why Charlie seems so weird, because she is partially possessed, but not fully. Yeah.
Well, like, yeah, I thought she was just possessed. Like, I didn't actually see this, but I heard like, allegedly, Ari Aster said in an interview, Charlie is not actually in the movie. Like it's just Paimon the whole time. But again, I don't know who said that.
I think that's an interpretation you could take away from it.
But anyways, so like, I know he's a trickster god. It makes sense that he's pulling pranks. Like the idea that he's like pulling, you know, he's playing with your expectations, the whole thing of the mom catching on fire. But then it subverts your expectations later.
Exactly.
It feels like a joke.
Exactly. Because that's a good prank. The god of chaos. Like he loves to fuck with people.
So, I can buy that this is all Paimon's influence. It's him doing it. That makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Hail Paimon. Color cues.
You were mentioning that. And what do you mean by that? I'm curious.
So like I did notice that it kind of seemed like baby blue, like a pretty baby blue is what was like a color signifier for either Paimon or the cult or their interest. But like the light. It's kind of vaguely, it's like kind of whitish, but it's like blue tinted.
Yeah.
But like whenever Paimon knocks over the paint onto the Joni's phone number, because if you look at it, like she doesn't knock it over.
She never touches it. It falls on its own.
Yeah, it falls on its own.
That's intentional. Ari pointed out in the AMA.
Yeah.
He's like, because someone said, I slowed it down frame by frame and she never touches it. And he's like, I know.
so like, you know, I started thinking, okay, baby blue Colt.
Yeah.
And then...
I didn't know it, but I'm thinking now the car where Charlie gets her head decapitated is blue. Peter's room is blue.
Uh-huh. His shirt at the end.
Yeah, he's wearing a blue shirt at the end.
The hallway in the high school. Like it's like that baby blue, and it's like, you know, when it does that, like he's being guided. Joan tried to cast him out and he's like kind of like zoning in. And then that's right before he like slams his face on the desk.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. I feel like baby blue is like a whole thing. But also orange, which would be the opposite. I guess that would make sense because, Charlie was wearing orange, but that was like an imperfect. Yep. It's the inverse. It's an and she's an imperfect vessel, according to the movie.
She wears that orange hoodie.
It's like telling you
the treehouse has that orange glow all the time.
That's right. Yeah. She's always up there.
That was fun. Like you could tell the difference between the orange glow of the heat lamps versus the candles that were lit in the end.
Yeah, because it's different.
And, like before he like notices that like there's something wrong. Oh, it's not heat lamps. It's candles out there.
Yeah.
Anyways.
No, that's
bird
cool.
No, imagery.
No. Anyways, that's good stuff. I didn't fucking catch that. Yeah. So like, yeah, that's colors. Awesome. I don't fuck with colors.
What do they mean?
And like initially when I was watching the movie, I was thinking, oh, well, like blue's a nice color. And Joni, like her what's the actress's name?
For who?
Joni.
Oh, I don't have it in front of me. I'm
she's
sorry.
Incredible. But
she's in The Leftovers. She's really good in that, apparently.
I've heard the good things about that. I've also heard good things about her in, what is it? Elizabeth Moss. It's the
The Handmaid's Tale.
The Handmaid's Tale.
She's in that.
She's in that as well.
She's the enforcer lady. Yikes. She's the big one.
But she felt so warm and like such a nice. Right. Like the sound like is less stressful whenever she's on screen. Like she has a warming presence.
She's very Machiavellian because she knows how to manipulate people.
She's so manipulative.
She does that thing where she keeps invading your space and touching you to divert your attention and like get you to like listen to her.
Like the cone of attention or whatever.
Yeah, she's really good at that, because like in that scene where she catches Toni Collette's character outside of the store, she keeps doing it because like every time she starts to walk away, she like brings her back in.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's so manipulative.
And Dowd.
And Dowd.
Thank you. Dowd. Yeah.
I do this.
No, that's important. We need a computer guy.
And the thing you were saying about the color cues too, you know, you could chalk that up to being, you know, incidental or accidental, but no, Ari, 1000%, this is intentional. Like, I know him,
and
he will tell you, like, he had everything plotted out, you know what I mean? Like, there's so many, like, intentionalities here.
Yeah.
Well, and he's really thought about it. Or him and his production team. And I shouldn't just describe it all to him.
It is a bunch of people worked on it and made these decisions. Well, and just another thing this made me think of is, like, the light baby blue being, like, a pretty color, like, a nice color. Like, in the way it, like, ends, like when, you know, the bad thing happened, Paemon took over a new host, beautiful music, the world is as it should be.
It's a subversion too.
So like I like the color and also the music subversion. The whole bird thing is kind of neat. Like I don't know why there's bird imagery, but like there's a ton of it. Jared has something
there. There is a reason. I just don't have it in front of me.
Birds are the messengers of God.
Maybe it's like associated with Paimon or something like that.
Noah sent birds off to find land.
Yeah.
Doves are released at weddings. I don't know. Maybe that's something.
But like there's birds everywhere. I've seen like it. I think it says like when I watch it on HBO Max with subtitles, I think the is like described as a clucking, being a sound like a bird makes. You know, there's the treehouse, there's like the pigeon head. That's like, all right. So I'm going to go back to the Joan's apartment.
Yeah.
Whenever Annie comes back to Joan's apartment, you see Charlie's toys presented like basically the ending scene of the movie where there's her headless toys are bowing down towards the toy that she created that has the pigeon head.
Right. Yes.
And then you see decapitated heads of a couple other animals, like a rabbit and something else there as well. So, you know, just mirroring the end of the movie. Yeah.
That was cut from the film, but in her little box that she keeps hidden from her parents and stuff up in the attic or in the treehouse, she has heads of multiple animals, but they only did a bird in the movie. But she has like rabbits and squirrels and stuff in there.
You see the decapitated heads on that table, but attention to it.
You see them throughout the movie, and she's hiding them from her parents.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, she doesn't want them in the script. But she doesn't want them to see it because she knows it's weird.
But she's aware. but something else, I haven't heard of this anywhere. Whenever Peter bangs his face on the desk, his nose bandage is kind of like a beak. I don't know. That's just me saying things. I don't know.
I mean, you're not wrong. There must be something there.
He's got a beak making clucking noises.
Maybe.
But why? Do we know why? No.
No, I couldn't find any connection about birds. I don't know what the significance is there. I will say decapitated heads, though. Paimon has a thing about heads for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also that's how he needs to be reincarnated into yep. you know, that's Peter's part of the body. Ceremony. So yeah, yeah, that's why Charlie's obsessed with cutting heads off and then reassembling them on the found objects. Just,
it's a thing that Paimon likes.
Yep. Yeah, yep. No head.
No head. Not in this movie.
Fuck.
No bitches.
Yeah, it's a hell of a
mine.
Oh yeah, the yeah, you can like see in the book that discusses Paimon within the movie, like it's like him sitting on a camel, but you see like three heads together, yeah, like on his side or whatever. Yeah, yep. So, anyways, it's there.
They did their research.
That shit is real. That's the freakiest thing. Like,
yeah.
Like,
yeah,
he's in the Old Testament.
Yeah, it's totally real.
It was the minor key of Solomon, I think, is the thing that it appears. Like
is that one of the books that he's listed
I think that's like the one that lists like the lords of hell.
Will, to relate this to something you know, it's like he's in a Warhammer Codex and he's one of the chaos lords.
Oh yeah, he's one of the chaos gods. If this
like
movie
Slaanesh
is
or something.
No, 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 no. Yeah. If this movie has taught me anything, he is the great lord of change and trickery, Tzeentch.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
There you go. And actually, to make it even more of a connection, the common creature associated with Tzeentch is birds and feathers. Huh.
The
greater demon of the Lord of Change is of avian features.
Huh.
Hmm. Interesting.
Hmm. Interesting.
GW just likes to steal shit.
Speaking of the birds, I do think Charlie's linked to it because it's when she gets distracted and annoyed by her teacher when that bird breaks into the window and dies.
I didn't think about that.
She has a connection to it.
I didn't think about her causing it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like the omen. It feels like something out of that.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah. There's something there, but I can't quite put my finger on what
we're
going to
do. Hereditary 2. Actually, you know what? After this podcast, let's just summon Paemon and ask him.
Listen, I've got
the candle going. I can turn the rest of the lights off. I've walked out the windows. Okay. So speaking of Joan's apartment, there's so many interesting things that happen in those small scenes. But when Annie is there and she's drinking tea that Joan brought her,
yes,
she pulls like an herb out of her mouth. Mm-hmm. It's part of an invocation spell that Joan is doing.
She gave her weed? Tea.
No, it's a herb.
I know.
like in Rosemary's Baby with like the tea.
Oh, they have the tea in Rosemary's Baby?
Well, it's
been long.
No, they keep giving Rosemary Tannis root, and that's what it is in that.
It's been 15 years
same.
Since I've seen
that movie. I'm ready to revisit either.
I don't know if this is a thing either, but like just some YouTube channel like pointed out, if you look really closely at the picture of a grandma feeding baby Charlie, like it looks like there's like green shit at the bottom of the bottle.
Oh god.
Like as if
really
like, yeah, like that was part of the ceremony to but I don't know, I'd have to like take a closer look at that.
I wouldn't be that shocked, actually, if that's true. Yeah, but the diorama of it is upsetting enough.
Well, yeah, like,
it's awesome. I love that.
Well, I don't know how you put whatever Tannis root in. I guess you just eat it and then it comes out in the milk. I don't know.
Gross.
I don't know.
The way my heart dropped when you realize Annie's making a miniature of the car accident.
Yeah.
And the father jumps all over her. And he's like, Jesus Christ, what the fuck? What if Peter sees this?
She's like, it's a neutral view.
But hold on, guys. I mean, like, it's her way of dealing with grief. She did the same thing with her mother.
I get that. But Steve's point is like, what if our son sees this?
Yeah, I understand that. It's callous, but I mean, she's shown herself to be kind of callous to him.
I mean, yeah that's which the is thing.
Maybe it's a problem.
Maybe it is. You're not wrong.
So something that I remember taking note of is, so in Annie's dreams,
yes,
or when she's sleepwalking, mm-hmm. I should say, mm-hmm. she's trying to kill her children.
Yes.
She's done it twice now.
Once,
you know, we learn about
therapy
in retrospect. And the second time we actually witness it. And she's trying to rip Peter's head off.
Now, I wasn't sure if that was actually her doing that or if it was just a dream.
She's in the room.
Yeah, but there's no space behind the bed.
I agree, but I assume it is her.
Okay. Anyways,
because he accuses her of doing it when he realizes she's in the room with him.
Or it's another Paemon joke.
Yeah.
Got you again.
Regardless, like she has attempted to kill her children at least on one occasion. And I wonder if that is intentional. Like, she is trying to subvert the cult's plans.
Yeah, I can see that.
Or if she is just feels burdened by them and wants them out of her lives, because you can tell she feels like a bothered,
there's probably a
put upon mother, you know?
Yeah, there's probably like a couple layers of interpretation. Like, either she's subliminally trying to undermine the cult's like machinations, or, right, you know, you can have the other read of like family issues and the way that like Babadook and like maternal issues with kids,
because she's already kind of cold to them, especially to the son. Mm-hmm. And he even accuses her, you know, he's like, why are you afraid of me?
Mm-hmm.
And you could argue that it's subconsciously she knows that he's, mm-hmm, you know, a vessel for an evil spirit.
Yeah,
I think that could be part of it too.
I do think that absolutely could be part of it.
But on a more grounded level, like, I think that is a thing that happens with like mothers and their teenage sons, you know, especially as they grow older, mm-hmm, is like there becomes that separation of like a boy aging out and no longer becoming a mother's baby, essentially, mm-hmm, and like having to like respect and even fear him in some case, you know, and it becomes it's a difficult relationship, you know, mm-hmm, between 17, 18, 19.
Yeah.
And I think this movie deals with that in a very, very nuanced way that like you don't really see done in a lot of movies. Of course, there's the supernatural twist to it, which is wonderful.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, like, again, there could be like, there's the cult reason, and then there's the family drama reason, right, for things happening.
And that's why that this movie is constantly just twisting the needle in your arm about everything going on, the tensions between, mm-hmm, the family, and how much, you know, Charlie's accident is now ripping them apart even more.
Yeah.
And then and then you're worried about the gallery viewing, you know, like, oh no, is she going to get these measures done in time?
What about the SATs?
Has Peter signed up for his SAT prep class? You know, like, what is going on there?
Yeah, no, that's true. All the real life stuff kind of goes by the wayside.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Once everything goes batshit the night that it happens,
mm-hmm, like, none of that, you're just not consequential. You're not, right,
and you're not prepared for it.
Yeah.
To get that insane, and when it does, it's just so upsetting.
Yeah,
yeah,
and shocking.
You gonna be okay, Jared?
I think Jared's okay. I think
Paemon is in my throat.
mommy, I'm scared.
Oh God, yeah. Well, that Paemon jokes. Like, that didn't sound like Charlie's voice. Like, that sounded like, you know, just a. I don't think it was Annie, like,
well, is it Toni Collette doing a bad impression?
Yeah, actually Toni Collette doing an impression? I mean, it sounded like a kid. It didn't sound like that kid.
I think the read on it could be that Paimon is fucking with the family.
That feels more correct to me.
There's a deleted scene after that moment where Steve takes her outside and he's like, you have to stop this. You are freaking us out.
Yeah.
And she's like, what do you mean? What happened when I blacked out? And he's like, he won't tell her. You know, and he's like, stop this.
Was this before shit is or after the seance? I can't remember.
It's right after the first one.
Yeah, they've invited it into their house.
It's over. Yeah. Because she does the invocation spell before that by herself. She's reading Latin in that room.
So I think this is another maybe deleted or cut thing. But earlier in Joan's apartment, whenever Joan's trying to give the instructions to Annie, like, you can tell there's like a bit of ADR when Jody's trying to like say, okay, make sure everyone's in the house.
Yeah.
And that's what you hear in the movie, but you can see her mouth room. Because I don't know if they just decided, oh, it doesn't make sense to like have her say this chant in front of her family. Like maybe they couldn't make that work. But anyway, so it was just a little bit of ADR that was there.
Well, yeah, when she's clearly stressing to her that, like, you have to follow this, like, step by step, you know?
Yeah,
you're
like,
oh, no. Oh, no.
Yeah, it's cool to watch her jump, like, when you know, to, like, watch her jump between, like, seeming empathetic and kind. But then you're like, okay, now she's like, okay, I got to get the instructions out. She, like, opens the drawer. It's like, I got the instructions here. Here's the candle.
Not only that, but, like, in the middle of the seance, like, Toni Collette stops her. And Joan seems so annoyed. She's like, what do you mean? Stop.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
She's like, what?
Oh, and the way she like brushes past like the detail about the mats or the floor mats.
Yeah.
It's like, oh yeah, my mom made stuff just like this. And she's like,
oh, isn't that special?
That's interesting. Anyways.
I need you to summon a fucking demon.
Yeah.
it's so good.
Yeah.
I'm glad you liked it, man.
Thanks. I don't think we really talked about that last scene, but that was nuts. I mean, we talked about the head cutting off.
What the fuck could you possibly, there's a bunch of naked people with the decapitated bodies and shit. It's crazy.
It's funny that his mom cutting her head off wasn't like the last straw for him. It was like turning around and seeing the naked people, and then he jumped out the window.
Yeah, it's like, what the fuck is going?
Yeah, he goes,
and jumps out the window. The fakest, ever. Like, the more I see it, the funnier it gets. But he just goes,
You know what? Maybe it was too hard on his performance. And maybe he is actually a bad actor.
he's so good otherwise.
Oh, yeah. Well, I will say, that scene works so, so well in a theater, especially with, a proper projection.
Mm-hmm. Which
scene? And I don't know. The ending scene, especially once Alex wakes up.
Oh, you're talking about, in the... Up in the...
Yes, when notice, so if you're watching this at home on, a bad TV, a poorly calibrated TV
in my
or
house,
something.
Yeah.
Or, and if the sun's out or something, sure, you're watching in the middle of the day or something, you're not going to notice that, his mom is up in the rafters behind him.
Especially
the first shot, because it's very dark. And then the second shot, it's a lot easier to see, but that's when he actually notices it too, finally. But then the guy from the funeral is standing in the corner too, watching
it. After
the dad catches fire, and it goes from day to night.
Uh-huh.
It zooms out. It shows the exterior of the house, and it goes, it goes from day to night.
Uh-huh.
And then you see if you're in a theater, you're going to notice it.
Oh,
I think at home you won't. Yeah, because I remember you going,
a bunch of naked people out in the forest.
Yeah, all the cultists are just standing around the house naked.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, just outside.
It's so unsettling. It's wonderful.
It's so funny. I guess it's the whole miniature aspect of it. But a lot of this movie oddly reminded me of Wes Anderson. But it's about the perfect framing, the way everything's supposed to look like it's in the dollhouse.
Yeah.
I felt that. And
everything's manicured,
yeah. And then all of a sudden you see, here's a cast of naked cultists in the woods, and they're all facing you. It was cute in that way.
It's a great point, but I'm sorry, Jared's going to have to cut all of that.
I'm keeping it in. In fact, I'm doubling it because I love it.
Shit. That's good.
Observation.
Yeah.
So Ari Aster's just the horror version of Wes Anderson.
He's a horror Wes Anderson.
You can cut it.
There is an amazing SNL sketch where
I've seen it.
Yeah, what if Wes Anderson made a horror movie? It's wonderful.
I don't think I would watch it.
Okay,
I don't
think that's you.
Well, I mean, it's making fun of us. You might like it, but maybe, also maybe you just can't tolerate even the mockery of it.
Even parodies of something you can't stand.
Yeah.
It's pretty bad.
Yeah.
It actually did remind me of a very unserious version of the Strangers.
Oh,
you've seen that movie?
Yeah.
And a little bit of Your Next. We really need to watch Your Next.
Are these home invasion movies or something?
Yes, okay. Both of them are. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I haven't seen a ton of those.
Steven, man, I can show you the world, baby.
I'll watch more of this shit.
What have we glossed over?
I don't think that we're really missing anything. Yeah. I mean, you
car
two
crash,
are both pointing out shit that even I have not noticed.
Yeah. I had
And
more.
I've watched this movie five fucking times.
Yeah.
I'm trying really hard to think of anything that's jumping. I think we did a pretty good job. Nothing else is occurring to me right now. I was just thinking about that scene after Steve catches on fire, and you see Toni Collette's face. They're at the horror, but then the light goes over. And the way that she that's another piece of acting I love. Her just face changes.
That's the reason why I've missed so much of this hidden context shit, because I'm just so fucking focused on Toni. Anytime she's on the screen, I'm give me the performance. Yeah. I need this.
I kind of want to pay more attention, go back where I know some supernatural stuff is happening in the movie. I did see pointed out to me, I didn't notice this myself, but the scene where the paint's knocked over onto the phone number. There is actually the light of Paemon in the background.
Snap.
So it's I want to pay attention more to whenever the bird hits the window, and
see if there's anything else that signifies.
Little details that are there, because it's that was crazy whenever I saw that.
It's cool, man.
Yeah,
I love this movie.
I loved it too. I'm very happy about it.
I'm glad you liked it, man. Seriously.
Thank you. I'm really glad that Jared,
reached out
and I feel bad for putting off for so long. I need to get over whatever hangups I have.
Have you watched any of Robert Eggers' stuff?
What did he do?
So he did The Witch. Obviously,
I did see that.
The Lighthouse.
I have not seen The White House.
Lighthouse.
I have not seen it.
I would say his scariest movie is The Vivitch. He hasn't really, The Lighthouse is kind of a horror movie, but not really.
And then the Northmen. Yeah.
I heard that was great, but no.
And you just watched Green Knight recently, right?
Oh, the Green Knight was Green amazing. Green Knight
fucking rules, dude.
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah.
Green Knight and Northmen are like two incredible movies that like had big budgets and then nobody saw them, but they're fucking amazing.
Except us.
The Green Knight was extremely good. Yeah, I just watched it on Max while like folding laundry or something like that, but I loved it. Shit. It was really, really good.
We'll cover it and we'll have you on for that. That movie is nuts. Like, I have spent so much money on like multiple like physical editions of that movie, and Will
bought me one off
the fucking him. Dungeons and Dragons like
on
it.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
The Dungeons and Dragons campaign?
A24 like put it out for the movie
for the Green Knight. Yeah,
I can't imagine it's action packed.
It shouldn't. It doesn't need to
D&D.
Be.
It's D&D.
Oh yeah, but like, well, I guess D&D isn't necessarily. So never mind. Okay,
and like, yeah, you don't have to. D&D doesn't always have to be combat. You know, there's puzzles and stuff. I like combat. Sometimes that's what I like.
But. Sometimes it's just being, you know, seduced by a very nice guy's wife, and then having to kiss him later. Yeah.
So or, did you take?
Or having a little fox companion lead you, you know, astray.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, and then Barry Keoghan like. Fucking with you, man.
Hard. Oh man, that actor's great too. Yeah. That's
yo, have you seen the most recent film that he was in? The fucking Saltburn.
No,
yeah, that's a wild ride.
Yeah, I should watch. A lot of people are talking about it. I should jump on it. I already have stuff spoiled for me that
I'm sorry.
Know about,
I'm a hater of that movie.
That's okay. You can hate it. Sorry. Okay. It's one of those films that like has a message, but it's not like it doesn't like go double down on it. I think
no, it triples down.
Oh, it's goes like, too
did
hard.
You get it? Did
too
you hard. Get it? Okay, did you realize it was the bad opposite. Guy the whole time?
It's the opposite.
Yeah, no, I got that.
What was the movie that the what'd she do? It started
pretty young.
It had Florence Pugh in it. It was directed by Olivia Wilde.
Booksmart? No.
No, the other one.
Oh, with Chris God. Pine. Oh my God. What is that movie called?
It's so fucking forgettable. Like, I'm sorry. It's really bad. She like toes the line of a really important message and then just never like crosses it.
Hmm.
And it's like so vapid and stupid.
All right.
Read the fucking outro. Let's go.
I have to pull up that movie. Hang on.
Oh, no.
Don't Worry, Darling.
Yeah, there it is.
Oh, yeah. I heard like people... talked a lot about that
when people were watching it and being like, what the fuck. I had to pull up the synopsis and read it and just like laugh about it. Well, folks, that's been our show. Thank you for listening to Debaser. If you enjoyed this episode, please subscribe to us on your podcast app and follow us on social media by searching for @DebaserPod. Our guest today has been Steven. Steven, where can people find you? And do you have anything you'd like to plug?
I'm usually not out. I don't have any like other projects. This is the first like public appearance I've ever made. This is my debut.
Oh hell yeah.
I've been summoned.
He's out.
So
hail Steven.
You can rewind this podcast and you can find me there.
Hell yeah. All right. My wonderful co-host is Will Taylor as always. Will, where can people find you and would you like to plug anything?
Everybody knows pocket_infinity on Instagram. I haven't painted anything. I've actually been like incredibly busy with work. I don't know when.
Well, you've been painting for regular work, for my regular not work commissions. Yeah.
And I don't know when this is dropping. It's probably dropping
two weeks from now in
Dallas. So, like, hey, if you're at the Dallas Open, come by the store. Say hi.
Cool. Well, that's a wrap, everyone. Good night and good luck out there.
Bye.
Bye.